rows and flows of angel hair and ice cream castles in the air and feathered canyons everywhere. I've looked at clouds that way, but now they only block the sun. They're rain and snow on everyone. So many things I would have done, but clouds got in my way.
I arrived at the Isle of Wight Festival with my manager and Neil Young. Neil was also managed by Elliot Roberts. And for the occasion, Neil Young had rented an old red Rolls Royce that was really a horseless carriage. It had a driver sitting outside with everything but the reins. And it was flamboyant. And as we arrived at the Isle of Wight, immediately our manager was arrested for possession of marijuana. And they cheerfully arrested him, they cheerfully locked him up overnight, and they cheerfully took a lot of money off of him.
One, two, three, four.
Then the festival began, which was a bit of a disaster.
Good morning.
I thought it might be a nice idea this afternoon to go down and see the groups and ask the groups to play for free, to show like they're willing to transform the mess that's happening already, like with that fence and things, into a peaceful, semi-free, free concert.
The only problem is they've been paid already.
They've been paid already?
Yeah.
Well, we'll just ask them to give the money back.
It was the Hate the Performer Festival, mainly because a lot of the performers showed up in elaborate vehicles. There was an expression of wealth taking place among the performers. Donovan brought a gypsy caravan with beveled glass windows. That was my dressing room at this event.
Without a ticket. So please have a ticket and have it ready to show the students.
This festival was started as a commercial concern, but it's fast becoming a people's festival, you know? And if necessary, we're going to enter the festival ground in order to hear what we came to see, you know? And I think that most of the musicians will back us up. And if they don't want to play because we're not paying to hear them play, then they can go, you know, as far as we're concerned. And I think there's quite a few thousand people here who feel the same way.
If they're going to break the wall down, the Isle of Wight County Council will come along here tomorrow and they will get the police in. They won't say, please put the wall back. They will say, no festival. They will take away the electricity. They will take away the water. They will take away the lighting. And there will be no festival.
This place is stinks, man. It's nothing but money. It's not a good thing about this festival.
You are the second establishment, man. Yes, you are the second establishment.
Yeah,
you're the new establishment, man.
Well, it's called just a, you know, like a rip-off. It's called, they're just ripping us off. It's not, the music isn't revolutionary at all. You know, it's called big business.
So the temperament of the festival was difficult, and I was chosen to come on late at night when it was dark so that I couldn't really see any disturbances, and with a hope that they would be quiet enough that I could hear myself.
All right, I'll get these other monitors for you.
Bob,
how's it going?
Listen, what have you got on next, Richard?
10 years after, Mungo Jerry, Free, Miles Davis, Doors, Who, Melanie, Emerson, Lake and Palmer, Sly and the Family Stone. Don't know what's happened to that.
Right, Ricky, the police said we can't run on Monday.
Did they?
I don't even know.
Absolutely, out of the question.
Why did you ask
them?
We're
going to have to run until the early hours this morning.
We just cannot run on Monday.
Well, look, we've got to stop early tonight somehow.
Just can't. It's impossible. It's out of the question.
How far is the running order behind?
The running orders are 5 hours behind.
Going on.
Why?
Because none of the artists showed on the right time. We are
stardust. I was sitting in Donovan's trailer when the promoters came back and begged me to go on in the middle of the afternoon. Acts had pulled out, the audience was hostile, you know, and I said faintly, no, I don't go on till 9 o'clock. You know, they begged and pleaded, said, Joan, we have no one to go on. I have a feminine cooperative streak, so reluctantly I said, okay. And they fed me to the beast. And we got to get ourselves back to the garden.
Ladies and gentlemen, for the second time in this country, and it's a real honor to have her on the Isle of Wight Festival, please everybody give the warmest welcome to Miss Joni Mitchell.
This is a song about a midway. It's called that. It's called That Song About the Midway. I met you on a midway at a fair last year, and you stood out like a ruby in a black man's ear. You were playing on the horses, oh, you were playing on the guitar strings. You were playing like a devil wearing wings, wearing wings. So grand, wearing wings. Do you tape them to your shoulders just to sing? Can you fly? I heard you can. Oh, can you fly like a hunting from the sky? I followed with the sideshows to another town, and I found you in a trailer on the camping. You were betting on some young lover. You were shaking up the dice, and I thought I saw you cheating once or twice. Once or twice I heard your bid. Oh, once or twice were you wondering, was the gamble worth the price? Pack it in, I heard you did. Oh, pack it in, pack it in. Was it hard to fold a hand you knew could win? So lately you've been hiding, it was somewhere in the news. And I'm still at these races with my ticket stubs and my blues. And a voice calls out the numbers, and it sometimes mentions mine. And I feel, Lord, I feel like I've been working overtime. Overtime, I lost my fire now. Overtime, overtime. Always playing one more hand for one more dime. I'm slowing down. I'm getting tired now, slowing down, slowing down. And I envy you the valley that you found, 'cause I'm midway down this midway, slowing down. Chelsea morning, and the first thing that I heard was a song outside my window, and the traffic wrote the words. It came a ringing up like Christmas bells, and wrapping up like pipes and drums. Oh, won't you stay? We'll put on a date, and we'll wear it till the night comes. Woke up, it was a Chelsea morning, and the first thing that I saw was the sun through yellow curtains, and a rainbow on my wall. Blue, red, green, and gold to welcome you, crimson crystal beads to beckon. Show every second. When the curtain opens on a portrait of today, like singing that song so much. Let me sing you a couple of songs at the piano here.
I was an acoustic act, you know, standing in front of the mountains of amplifiers that The Who provided, and only a band like The Who could play successfully to that enormous of an audience. In that an audience that big makes a lot of noise, period. You know, they just aren't all wrapped. And so I approached the thing with dread.
musician who plays in New York City. There are musicians like him all over the place, just standing around and playing their music and hoping that maybe somebody will like what they're doing. It's called Real Good for Free.
You know, when I'm sitting up here and playing, and I hear all those people growling out there and people saying, "Joni, smile for Amsterdam," and stuff. It really puts me up tight, and I forget the words, and then I get nervous, and it's really a drag. So, you know, I don't know what to say. Just give me a little help, will you, so that I can... This is a song about another festival that... This is a song about a festival that I didn't get to go to. I got as far as the New York airport, and then I got kind of left behind. But I watched it all day on television, and I wrote a tune about it. And it's called Woodstock. Is he okay? Wait, what's...
One, two. A doctor, please, a doctor.
To my right and about five rows back, a guy flipped out on, I guess, what was acid, some kind of bad drug.
Carry him back here. If you can, carry him back here.
He came out of the audience like a fish out of water, and making a sound like the damned, a low bellow came out of him, and it disturbed everybody immediately around him. And from that vantage point, you could see the ripples of that disturbance travel quickly to the back, even though I don't suppose that the ripples knew why they were rippling. People began to stand up all over in this crowd of, what was it, 600,000 people.
Ah!
back. I have an announcement that I've been asked to make. Desolation Row is this festival, ladies and gentlemen. There is a... No, I'm sorry. Yeah, it's groovy, I know.
Hang on, security guards, come off the stage. Security, come off the stage.
She's doing something false and forming.
This is my festival!
Oh,
unhand me, I haven't done anything yet.
Okay,
let go of me! Let go of me! What have I done? Let go of me! I can walk!
Have you been taking this on film?
No, not all of it.
Am I under arrest or earned on
you? Not.
All right, let's get that straight.
Hey, wait, you're cool, man.
Groovy.
Hey, wait, just relax for a minute, man.
Lots of us are uptight.
I know it, man, but wait a second.
We're uptight about commercial music co-opting our festival.
Hey, listen, man, wait a second.
Ain't
you listening for a minute?
Who buys the musicians?
Hey, wait a minute, man.
How much do you sell your music for?
Wait a second, man.
Yeah, well, we got caught enough. He's coming out the arena.
Come on,
just
let me talk to him.
Come on, let's go.
Don't push him.
Don't push
him. He'll walk out.
No, I can make you crucify me, man.
No, look.
You know, and I've got it. I've been shooting a film about him with Todd.
He'll walk out with me.
Yeah, well, go on now. Come on.
Hey, come on with me, man.
Well, there's one reason I can't go.
Because
I've got the Lord of the Rings, my flutes, and a drum on stage. They belong with
them.
You stay at the gate. Somebody go get it for me, right now.
All right, we're standing here.
If I'd been allowed to go on stage, we might have discovered that I was one of the most coherent people around here. Coming to talk to an old friend of mine, Joni Mitchell.
Please,
we are still, we are
look,
stardust.
With the festival,
we are gold.
I'm only taking pictures.
Got to get ourselves back into the garden.
Listen to me, man.
We're caught in the devil's bargain, which to me means a lot of the debts, a lot of the very complicated economics of this festival, which spent more money, £400,000 more money on iron fences than they did on amplification. No, I'm going to finish.
I know.
Ricky Farr, or whatever his name is, came to me on Wednesday. He gave me 100 tickets and named me the head of the official committee to paint the fence invisible, okay? He wanted to paint the fence invisible at the time because it was embarrassing him. At that time, I suggested to him that he put a few swivel panels on it. Since then, we've discovered that it isn't a question of money. We're all middle-class children and we can afford to have our festival. We could have afforded to have it at a dollar more expensive and had it without fences.
They were painting, you know, obscenities and swastikas and things on it and trying to tear it down. The fence was preventing the music from being free.
They should just open up the gates and let all the people listen to the music. It doesn't matter about the wall here.
I think the musicians should show that they're not bound by the money strings and offer to play for free. You know, it's as simple as that. Just to show that, like, the people who are supposed to be up there, like, representing us, if you like, make the first move and play for free.
But business is business. Shoes aren't free, you know. Tobacco is not free. Why, you know, why should music be free? But this display of wealth, I guess, was the point of contention. There was this sense that the artists had all sold out, why they had put their hopes in rock and roll politics, I have no idea. You know, knowing the Pantheon, they shouldn't have put their hopes there anyway. But there seemed to be a time where the music, where the artists and the people were equals, and suddenly everyone was displaying an inequity.
Well, a lot of the music is about this sort of thing. Even if the people that play it are sort of being hypocritical, originally that this music was an expression of their feeling against the establishment and against sort of capitalism against selfishness and greed and everything else, you know.
A handful of rabble-rousers seem to be the mean-spiritedness of the dragon, of this enormous crowd.
Power to the people, motherfuckers! Just 1 minute. I've been to Woodstock, and I dug it very much. I've been to about 10 fucking festivals, and I love music. I just think one thing. This festival business is becoming a psychedelic concentration camp where people are being exploited. And there's enough of that. What is all this peace and love shit when you have police dogs out there? What about that? That reminds me of a lot of bad things, you know? I don't like police dogs.
The only thing you gotta do is just do what you want to do now. For God's sake, do what you want to do now. And if it's the right thing, you can do it.
The promoters had been standing their ground. They'd tried everything to calm this audience down. They'd yelled at them. They'd pleaded with them that, you know, they'd sent in an Anglican minister, you know, who didn't have a hope in hell.
Well, it's been a wonderful festival.
Hey, shut up down there.
We want the fence down! We want the fucking fence!
There's a hardcore of people here who are admittedly revolutionaries, and they intend to institute a revolutionary situation here. And, you know, we're against violence, but if anybody uses violence on us, we'll defend ourselves. And there's probably 40,000 people, I should think, here like that.
I wanted to run off stage. That, you know, you get your squirt of adrenaline, fight or flight. It seemed like appropriate time to flee, not to stand your ground. I sat there really wanting to run but feeling that I couldn't.
I get my feelings off through my music. But listen, you got your life wrapped up in it, and it's very difficult to come out here and lay something down when people... It's like last Sunday I went to a Hopi ceremonial dance in the desert, and there were a lot of people there, and there were tourists, and there were tourists who were getting into it like Indians, and Indians who were getting into it like tourists. And I think that you're acting like tourists, man. Give us some respect.
I was trying desperately to find something to latch on to say, but it became very emotional, very hurt, very, very mixed emotion, complex emotion, angry, you know, like ashamed of them in a certain way, indignant. And I'd been 2 weeks before to a Hopi snake dance ceremony. One snake launched itself at its full height into the tourists. The tourists freaked and screamed and scattered in all directions. So at that moment on stage, this is what flashed before my eyes. So what I said was very cryptic, you know, something about you're acting like a bunch of tourists, but I was drawing on that experience for strength. Had I not gone there 2 weeks before, I don't know what I would have drawn on, you know. After I said my little speech, the audience altered rapidly, and I had a revelation about audiences at that moment, that the first five rows, that it's a big dragon, it's a beast, and the first five rows are the eyes, and they telegraph all the way back to the tail, emotionally. the people in the front row, the ones that could see me and that I could see, immediately softened. They acted a bit like they had been reprimanded, but they warmed up. You know, I said, have some respect, and they did. I watched the rows back off, sit down, and they were quiet.
My old man, he's a singer in the park. He's a walker in the rain, oh, he's a dancer in the dark. We don't need no piece of paper from the city hall keeping us tied and true, my old man, keeping away.
So many
know the piano. I just, angels guide me, and I don't even know what I did. I'm an idiot savant, what can I say? Okay, I gotta get in the mood. I can't do this in front of people. What is music? I can't speak in general. I can tell you what it is to me. Chords are colors that depict the current state of your emotionality at the time that it's, speaking as a composer, okay, let's put it in that context. As a composer, at the moment that I sit down with the intention of composing, you know, I fritter across the piano or I strum across the strings until I find the chords that make me go, oh, at that moment. But most of music, pop music, it's like they get these formula chords, oh, the people like these chords, and so they play them ad nauseum, you know. So I think that's ick. Music is when you pull the chords from your inner core, whether they sound weird to people or not. And so, and anyone adventuresome is doing that. Now, my harmonic sense is, all my life I heard Joni's weird chords from rockers and jazzers, and some of them, they were annoyed. They'd say, the jazzers, not the great ones, but the near greats, you know. The near greats would go, that's wrong in jazz. And the greats, like Wayne and Herbie, would scratch their head and giggle, you know, like, and play very well. They wouldn't be intimidated by it. Well, Wayne said once, you know, well, these are not guitar chords and these are not piano chords. What are these chords? So for me, it was finding chords that depict my emotionality. Well, what made them strange, I believe, not all of them, but the ones that they thought were strange, was that I used a lot of sus chords. Not being an educated musician, I didn't know what a sus chord was, but I called them chords of inquiry. They had question marks in them. They were unresolved chords, and my life was full at any time of 5 or 6 unresolved problems. So I would go from one unresolved chord to another unresolved chord, have a nice warm chord with a second running right up the middle of it, kind of tucked in so it wasn't on the top where it really gets on your nerves, but tucked in along the middle, you know, like the way it was tucked in on me. Wayne eventually told me, well, I learned at Berklee School of Music, they taught us never stay on a sus chord too long and never go from a sus chord to a sus chord. So I guess I was going from a sus chord to a sus chord, maybe a little resolution back to a sus chord to, I don't know, I can't say, but it was strange to those people. It was against their education, you know, but it wasn't against my muse because my life was so full of unresolved things. So my harmonic movement was depicting my emotional situation.
I've been doing a bit of traveling on my own, aside from going places to sing, and this is a song about some of the places that I went to, and it's also a homesick song for California. It's called California.
Thank you.
I know all of you, and the streets are full of strangers. All the moon's a home you're in. Just give you the blues. So I bought a ticket.
DDT now. Give me spots on my apples, leave me the-
flows of angel hair and ice cream castles in the air and feather canyons everywhere. I've looked at clouds that way, but now they only block the sun. They're rain and snow on everyone. So many things I would have done, but clouds got in my way. Oh, I've looked at clouds from both sides now, from up and down, and still somehow, you know, it's cloud illusions. I recall I really don't know clouds at all. Moons and Junes and Ferris wheels, the dizzy dancing way you feel as every fairy tale comes real. Oh, I've looked at love that way, but now it's just another show. You leave them laughing when you go, and if you care, don't let them know. No, don't give yourself away. I've looked at love from both sides now, from give and take, and still somehow, oh, it's love's illusions. I recall I really don't know love. And fears and feeling proud to say I love you right out loud. Dreams and schemes and circus crowds, oh, I've looked at life that way. But now old friends, they're acting strange. They shake their heads, they say I've changed. Well, something's lost, but something's gained in living every day. Oh, I've looked at life from both sides now, from win and lose, and still somehow it's life's illusions. I recall I really don't know life.
I'm not addicted to playing live. I prefer the studio. Some people need the roar of the applause. I've often wanted to say, treat this evening like a play. Don't applaud till the very end. That monkey see, monkey do ritual of saying applaud. I've always used the applause just to tune up. The longer they applauded, the more in tune I could get, because I had these damn tunings that you weren't supposed to be putting a guitar into in the first place. But you know, it would feed you energy that, you know, too much of it and you get giddy, and, you know, you don't want to be revved up. You don't want to enjoy it too much. It's not good for you in the first place. You know, it's a hard drug to handle for most people, and it ruins their art. All of that cacophony, you know, that fluttering thing, like that, that's, noises affect animals. That's a funny noise to be generating.
Okay, here's a song I like to sing a lot. This is a song about an artist and his old lady, and sort of the dilemma of being the old lady to an artist, who is, of course, a connoisseur of beauty. Always running around connoisseuring all those beauties. Humor there.
Mm-hmm.
gentle with you, oh, with you. So I gave you all my pretty years, and we began to weather. And I was left to winter here, for you went west for pleasure.
Miss Joni Mitchell. I think you will all agree. I think every one of you will agree that despite the interruption, she did a beautiful job. Let her hear it backstage, please.
Difficult situation for a performer, and you know, I had come through it without cowardice, which was the natural instinct, you know. I came out and did another song. They gave me an encore, and at the end, I was beaming.
My whole heart's just going thump, thump, thump.
I saw part of Tiny Tim who came after me, and they didn't give him a hard time. So the beast had changed its mind that we were human, and they let everybody after that do their thing.
I was alone and sickly. was a quarter of a moonlit night. Oh, I heard him cry through my window shade, and it filled me so full of pride. But I could not turn my back on him. I put on the back porch light. Can I help you, said the good Samaritan. Can I help you, said the good Samaritan. I brought him bread and a blanket, and I told him, you can't come in. You can sleep outside in the tool shed, though a little rain comes in. Well, now, I don't know you, you're a stranger. I don't know where you've been. You can come in here, said the keeper of the inn. No, I don't want you in here, said the keeper of the inn. When I woke in the weary morning, he was gone. When I woke in the weary morning, he was gone. I thought maybe he was an angel, and I left him out in the rain. Oh, and what if he was a devil? He'll be coming back here again. But when I woke in the weary morning, he was gone.
Joni Mitchell.